Welcome to worship on this seventh Sunday after Epiphany. On behalf of American Lutheran Church, I welcome you this morning to our time of worship and fellowship. We extend a special welcome to all that are visiting us this morning, and please know that it's our hope at American Lutheran that you feel at home in our time of worship and fellowship. Pastor Carl told me to make sure my sermon was at least twice as long as normal because we're not going to do communion this morning. So we're not having Sunday school this morning either. After worship service, we're all invited to a fellowship hall for coffee and conversation. We ask that you keep all the following in your prayers: Cheryl Pauley, Laverne Hedman, Janelle Kelly, Wade Frosch, Gordon Jarman, Margaret Milhoff, Dennis Brock, Pat Jones-Scheit, Geraldine Hansen, Evelyn Adden, Charlotte Larson, Owen and Emmett, the infant sons of Jordan and Rochelle Wellberg. Also keep in your prayers the ministry of Mark and Susan Letty in Cameroon and the ministry of Jordan Hintz in Turkey. I want to thank the greeters this morning, Brian and Sarah Johnson, Mildred Schneck, the ushers Ralph Hansen, Mark Hintz, Byron Johnson, and Rich Kruger, the A.B. Booth, Gary Wellnitz, the assisting minister, Lori Hardy, the lector, Sarah Johnson, the acolyte, Bennett Schwinn, and the accompanist, Amy Alderman. And the coffee servers this morning are the high school youth. Please stand for the welcome and confession.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who stretches out all the heavens, who sends light to the nations, who gives breath to us all. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Loving God, we confess that we have turned from your way to follow our own ways.
Forgive us the times we have spoken or acted too quickly.
We have not spoken or acted at all.
We have hurt those closest to us.
We have hurt those we have yet to know. We have thought more about ourselves than others. We have thought less of ourselves than we ought. Turn us around and give us a fresh start so that we can live again, children. Amen. Even when we have done wrong, God makes us right. Even when we've messed up, God puts us together. God's love never runs out. He never tires of calling us beloved children. Hear God say to you now, your sins are forgiven for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Forgiving God, too often we take your forgiveness for granted. Too often we cling to our sin, believing that it is our right to harbor resentments and hatred. Be merciful to us and show us the depth of healing that is offered when you forgive for the sake of the one recognized total surrender to forgiveness and offered it willingly. Jesus Christ, our healer. Amen. Please be seated.
Psalm 130 will be read responsively by full verse. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you, there's forgiveness, so that we can, with reverence, serve you. I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord, more than watchmen wait for the morning. More than watchmen wait for the morning. The enormity of our sin is surpassed only by the mercy of God. We come, repentant, to the table of the Lord. In today's gospel from the 7th chapter of Luke, through a dramatic encounter of rich and poor, righteous and sinner, Jesus teaches the relationship between receiving mercy and responding with a lavish outpouring of love. Jesus also provokes his host by claiming authority to forgive sins. In the body and blood of Jesus, in the announcement of our absolution, all our sins are forgiven. Please stand for the gospel acclamation.
The Gospel according to Luke, the 7th and 8th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, so she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he thought to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would know who was touching him and what kind of woman she is, and that she is a sinner. Jesus, knowing his thoughts, answered him, Simon, I have something to tell you. Tell me, teacher, he said. Two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had money to pay him back, so he forgave the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon replied, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. Then he turned toward the woman and said to Simon, Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has been given little loves little. Then Jesus said to her, Your sins are forgiven. The other guests began to say among themselves, Who is this who even forgives sins? Jesus said to the woman, Your faith has served you. Go in peace. And from the 8th chapter, And soon afterwards, Jesus went through the cities and villages, preaching and bringing the good tidings of the kingdom of God, and with him the 12, and certain women who had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities. Mary, that was called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had gone out, and Jonah, wife of Chuzas, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others who ministered unto them of their substance. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Excuse me while I sit through this. My knee surgery didn't go so good this time. A Catholic bishop, a theologian, a rabbi, and a few Jews walk into... Wait a minute, it isn't that, but it sort of is. Let me explain. The main authors of the books of the New Testament were a Catholic bishop, a theologian, a rabbi, and a few Jews. The Christian church called Peter the first bishop or the pope. So he was a Catholic bishop. And before he followed Christ, he was a devout Jew. The gospel writers were Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew was a tax collector and a devout Jew before he met Jesus. Mark was a devout Jew and traveled with Paul and Barnabas on Paul's first journeys, then later with Barnabas and with Peter. Luke, who is called the first theologian, was a Gentile. Luke, the theologian, traveled with Paul, who had been the rabbi, on Paul's journeys and would have certainly known Mark and Peter. But unlike Mark, Luke stayed with Paul until Paul's death. Luke was likely in prison with Paul when Paul was killed. Luke was a physician and he was well schooled. Luke had first-hand knowledge of the Acts of the Apostles and wrote the epistle along with Luke's gospel. When God told Peter and Mark through dreams, they finally understood that they could baptize Gentiles too. In others, all are we equal. But they did not seem to consider woman or women equal. I find that odd. Finally, through the author, the Gospel of John, he is uncertain. I believe that it was one of the followers of the disciple. The book of John refers to John as the one Jesus loves, and John and the followers were Jews. Moreover, the author of John 1 and John 2 in the back of the New Testament was the disciple of John, a Jew. John's gospel was written about 80 AD. Now the gospel writings were most part written independently, except Luke and Matthew shared much of the information with Mark and a mysterious source called Q. The author of Q is unknown. These gospels were written many years apart, mostly independently, and from authors with varied backgrounds. Luke wrote a gospel that is a little different from the others, as you might expect, since he was the only Gentile writer. Luke told of women washing Jesus' feet just before today, during today's reading. And in addition, Luke portrays many women, including Mary, Elizabeth, and Anna, as courageous women who followed God's plan and whose voices praise God's arriving redemption in Jesus. It is also the case that Luke often pairs a story of a woman alongside of a story of man. For example, the healing of a centurion slave is paired with the raising of a widow's son. Jesus tells twin parables of a woman losing a coin and a man losing a sheep. With all the other authors except Paul highlighting men, how would Luke's writing be received? Luke wrote to a person named Theophilus, or perhaps to anyone who is a lover of God, because the Greek word Theophilus means lover of God. In Luke's text, Luke introduced women who followed Jesus in discipleship's parallel fashion to his introduction of the 12 male disciples. In fact, in today's text, Mary Magdalene, Jonah, Susanna, and many women are described in the same way as the 12. They are with him as Jesus proclaims the good news of God's reign. Mary Magdalene and Jonah are mentioned again in chapter 24 of Luke, and they were the first witnesses to Jesus' resurrection. So while the 12 are the most prominent disciples in Luke's narrative, he accents the role of women in Jesus' ministry in very important ways. Disciple charactership identifies both male and female followers of Jesus in Luke, and especially in Acts of the Apostle, Luke plainly states that some of the apostles and some of the disciples were women. In Jesus' first context, it would have been ideal to have both men and women disciples who could attend and minister to men and women, respectively, in the crowds coming to Jesus. Luke wrote about one thing that others evidently didn't think was important enough to mention. These gospel verses read today bring the difference to the forefront. Luke said that Jesus had many followers too. Now, isn't that something? The Middle Eastern communities still will have little to do with the recognition of women. It took 2,000 years before some Christian churches recognized women as leaders in the church. Indeed, South Dakota had the first woman bishop in the ELCA. And today, the presiding bishop in the ELCA is a woman. Yet many still do not recognize women, even though Paul did, and Luke did, and Jesus did. The repression of women is older than any religion, and it's justified in many religions, but in Christianity, there's a particular irony in that Jesus was so affirming of women. In a world where men and women lived largely segregated lives, it seems that women played a rather central role in Jesus' community. Jesus was gathering together not a school of elite students, but people who lived on the edge of society. And that would include single women and widows. These were not insiders, but outsiders. People who required social rehabilitation. When we approach a text like this, we need to look at ourselves. Where do we fit in this story? Are we the insider or the outsider? And that's by gender, ethnicity, education, sexual orientation, and religious background. I'm surely counted amongst the insiders. I'm like Simon, the Pharisee, the insider, who had Jesus at his house when the woman washed Jesus' feet with her tears. It's not that being on the inside is bad. It simply requires me to be more conscious of my own situation in life. Having been born an insider, how can I be aware of the presence and the gifts and the needs of those who are generally on the outside? There's more to it than the contempt that was shown women in many of the cultures and religions. Let me be perfectly clear. It's not just about men and women, is it? It's how we view people other than ourselves. If we were honest to God in our prayers, who would tell God who it is that makes us superior? 2,000 years ago, we can look back and point fingers at Simon, and indeed the entire society about dealing with women. Today, some people see someone different from them moving into the neighborhood, and it's almost like they would look at a convicted felons or drug pushers living next to the high school. Listen to Jesus' parable found in Luke 18. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed, "God, I thank you that I'm not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I got." But the tax collector stood at a distance, and he would not look up to heaven. But he beat his breast and said, "God, have mercy on me, a sinner." Jesus said, "I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Notice that the tax collector's prayer was from a humble heart, and God accepted it. It is the sin of the Pharisee, who was a haughty spirit, thinking that he was a better person. Paul says in chapter 2 of Romans that we are all equally guilty of sin. Perhaps one sin many are guilty of is that which Jesus brought up throughout his ministry. Jesus said, love God and love your neighbor. But getting closer to the point, do not hold yourself higher in regard than your neighbor. This may be something you and I can get down on our knees at night and pray about. Before I end, I got to tell a story. Excuse me, I hope it doesn't offend anybody. It seems that there was a busload of elderly ELCA couples, and they were going on a couples retreat. And on the way, a terrible tragedy occurred. Of course, everyone but the driver was killed in this horrible accident. Of course, all these good Lutherans went straight to heaven, where St. Peter was waiting for them at the gate. St. Peter said, you are the 12 couples that were killed in that bus crash, correct? And they said, yes, indeed. Peter said, okay, I need to break you up a little bit before I proceed. All you hen-pecked husbands, please move over here. 11 men moved right away. St. Peter looked at the man standing with the women. He says, are you hen-pecked, sir? Well, yes, I guess I am. So Peter said, why then did you not move with the rest of the men? The man answered, it's my wife. She said, you had better stay where you are. Now, I have a question for the men in the congregation. How many of you think you're better than your wife or your mother? Raise your hand. I didn't do it either. What could I do? Lori's sitting right back there. Besides, Lori said, you had better not raise your hand. Jesus said, love God with all your might. Love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus didn't differentiate between men and women. And Jesus didn't mean only people like ourselves. How do you feel, or how do we feel, about the most precious command our Lord gave us? The commandment Jesus said was the most important thing for us. Do we sometimes think that we are better than someone else? Do we have a haughty spirit? Amen.
Thank you.
Apostles' Creed. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Faithful God, inspire fidelity in your church. Guard it from temptation and make it a place of safety, welcome, and joy for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of all that is, we encounter you not only in the grandeur of your creation, but in its smallest and quietest parts. Awaken us to your presence all around us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of power and might, call the nations of the world to recognize first your authority and justice. Guard all nations from unjust rulers and bring forth your kingdom of righteousness and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of the lowly, help us recognize hospitality and generosity from unexpected sources, the humanity and the goodness of those in prison, the faith and persistence of those who weep. Let our weakness be our strength. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of new life, as you bring newcomers, visitors, and seekers into this assembly, give us hearts open to the new perspectives and the gifts they bring. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, you have called the saints your own. Gather us with them into your kingdom in the promise of life forever with you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting your promise to hear us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and glory forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us share God's peace with one another. Isn't this a wonderful thing? We have to wait for people to stop sharing the peace. I think it's awesome.
Let's stand for the blessing.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Thank you.
Go in peace. Be the light of Christ.